34 years ago, India lost one of the stalwarts of the freedom movement, Muhyiddin Ahmad Abul Kalam Azad. When the end came on February 22, 1958, he had a few trusted friends at his bedside. The one most affected was Jawaharlal Nehru, who was losing a lifelong friend and mentor. There were not many belongings in the household. A dozen khadi kurta pajamas, few cotton and woolen sherwanis, a worn-out hairbrush, and thousands of books were his only worldly possessions. His greatest legacy to India was a mind of unsurpassed intelligence and deep humanism. Azad was born in Mecca in 1888. His father was a scholar of eminence and a renowned Sufi. His mother, Alia Begum, was the daughter of the Mufti of Medina. She spoke Arabic to her children. The family migrated to Calcutta when Azad was 10 years old. He married Zulekha Begum in 1901 and their only son died in infancy. Azad was educated at home under the strict discipline of his father, Maulana Khairuddin. He studied traditional Islamic curriculum, Dars-e-Nizami, which he completed at an amazingly young age. His knowledge of Arabic and Persian was augmented by arithmetic, algebra, geometry, and Islamic theology. He learned Urdu on his own and similarly mastered the English language, although he was never to speak it all his life. His journalistic career, which started with Lisan-us-Sidq, or Voice of Truth, launched in 1903 at the age of 15, culminated with Al-Hilal and Al-Balagh, the two weekly journals that galvanized the Muslim community of India.
Maulana comes from a very orthodox religious family of India. Born in Mecca, heir to an important school of thought, very early in life, it seems, he deviated from Piri Muridi structure of the Muslim theologians. He was a man who creatively developed his own mind year after year by the experiences in India. His main concerns were two. His main concern was to build a wide national movement comprising all religious groups. And two, like Gandhiji, to emphasize that Hindu-Muslim unity, or rather Hindu-Muslim, Christian, Sikh, Buddhist, Jain unity is the only assurance of building a new India.
Long before Mahatma Gandhi came on the scene, Maulana had already established a paper, Al-Hilal, in 1912, with the avowed object of preaching sedition and driving out the British from India. Through this paper, he exhorted the Muslims to join the Hindus in driving out the British from India. The British government forfeited the security of the paper, and Maulana then started, undeterred, another paper, Al-Balagh. Through this paper, he had the same objective in view, to forge Hindu-Muslim unity and at the same time bring them together, the Hindus and Muslims, to get the country's emancipation.
Azad's years in prison were the most productive years of his literary life. Caught in the political hub, he could never pen the immortal words that illuminate page after page, whether written at Ranchi, at Alipur, at Bankura, or the most memorable piece at Ahmednagar.
He did most of his writing while behind the British bar, just like Jawaharlal Nehru. His Tazkira, his Ghubar-e-Khatir, his Tajmal-e-Quran, all his masterpieces were the product of the period when he was in jail. Maulana Azad added the much vital intellectual dimension to India's national movement. It was because of this that Jawaharlal always used to look upon him as the encyclopedist who preceded the French Revolution or the learned man of the Renaissance.
Had Azad's writings been rendered and translated in various languages of the world, he would have been one of the world's greatest prose writers. Azad's prose masterpiece is his book, Ghubar-e-Khatir, which could be roughly translated as the unburdening of the soul. And that is what Azad did. He unburdened himself when he was in prison at Ahmednagar in the early 40s for 3 years. He was in prison with his colleagues and friends, Jawaharlal Nehru, Sayyid Mahmood, and Asif Ali and others. He kept a very strict schedule of events. He woke up at 4 o'clock in the morning, and with great care and lovingly, he brewed himself a pot of tea. He placed meticulously his tea and his pen on either side and proceeded to write. What he wrote were letters to a friend of his, Nawab Sadr Yar Jung, which he never intended to publish as Ghubar-e-Khatir, but which he wrote as a spontaneous unburdening of his soul.
Maulana Azad was a great master of words, both spoken and written. I had some exposure to his speeches when he led the Indian delegation to the UNESCO conferences. I was attached to him as its press attaché. His performance at the full assembly was somewhat diminished by the fact that nobody there understood Urdu, and every sentence had to be translated by Humayun Kabir. But what I noticed that when he addressed smaller meetings, although again in Urdu, he was able to pitch his speech to the level of the audience. And I saw a better example of that back home. He addressed a meeting of the Sikhs of Delhi on Guru Nanak's birthday. And he pointed to the many colored lights that were on display around the pandal. And he said, "You see these lights, they're of different colors, blue, green, yellow, white. Yet the power behind, which gives them their colors, is one, electricity. It's the same way that although we have different religions in this country with different expressions, the power behind all of them is one, that is God." His written word, I'm not so familiar with his prose, either his two journals, Al-Hilal or Al-Balagh, but my first exposure really came when I read his Tarjamanul Quran. I've been involved in reading different translations of the Quran. I even tried to pick it up in Arabic, but I wasn't able to get the full meaning of the scripture till I read his Tarjamanul Quran. And for the first time, I realized the uniqueness of some of its aspects, particularly the first part, the Al-Fatiha. I think Maulana is quite correct in pointing out that this was the first attempt by any religious system to define God. In the end, I would like to say that I haven't heard the kind of oratory that I heard from Maulana Azad ever since he went. What Dr. Radhakrishnan did for Hinduism, Maulana Azad did for Islam.
At the age of 35, Azad was elected Congress president in 1923. He delivered his first presidential speech exhorting the Hindus and Muslims to become equal partners in the freedom struggle. He was once again elected Congress president in 1940 when he presided over the Congress session at Ramgarh. The high moment in the speech was his excellent rendering of the concept of composite culture.
There are so many aspects of a life, but I would like to only emphasize on two aspects of his life, which to me are most relevant and important even today. One is his deep belief in Indian nationalism and unity of people belonging to various religions, caste and creed. That belief was founded as early as 1912 when he was quite young, and which continued with him all his life. His famous Ramgarh session speech as the president of the Congress, when he said that I'm proud to be a Muslim, but I have the traditions of the 1300 years of Islam. I'm also very proud to be an Indian. The same thing he said in 1923, when the first time he became the Congress president, when he was only 35 years old. And he emphasized the unity of Hindus and Muslims. He emphasized the unity of Hindus and Muslims more than the freedom of the country.
He had used Islamic theology to emphasize need of Hindu-Muslim unity. One of the creative contribution of Maulana Azad, in my mind, whatever the orthodox may say, was he was able to give example of Prophet Muhammad himself in the very first year of migration to Medina, in which the Prophet was able to build a polity in Medina as an administrator. Prophet said, while we have our own religions and faiths, Christianity, Judaism, paganism, Islam, but politically we are one polity. And the word which Prophet used was Ummate Wahida. And Maulana rightly emphasizes by Ummate Wahida, Prophet meant one nation. But the point he was underlining was it is possible to have diverse religious system, yet single polity. That was a great ideological contribution which Maulana made from the theological heritage of Islam. Secondly, he mentioned that while religious diversities will persist in India, unity of the people is a must if we have to build glorious future. In his Ramgarh address, I think he underlined that if an angel comes down from the heaven and says that Hindu-Muslim unity has to be postponed but independence will come, I'll say no. I would rather have Hindu-Muslim unity prior to freedom, because if freedom is postponed, India will lose. If Hindu-Muslim unity is postponed, mankind will lose.
Was Azad a man for the pulpit or the cloister? He played the most prominent and delicate role in the intricate negotiations with the British government. But like an iceberg, only a fraction of his entity was visible and available for the masses. A wealth of knowledge, learning, dialectic was hidden underneath the garb of the Congress president, the president of the Jamiatul Ulema-e Hind, Minister of Education, Culture and Scientific Affairs.
He had got very admirable appreciation from Patrick Lawrence, Chiang Kai-shek, Sir Stafford Cripps, and number of other people who came to India, who came in contact with him, Lord Roy Wavell, for example. It was because of his scholarly background that he was at his best at the negotiating table, whether it was the Cripps mission or whether it was the cabinet mission. Actually, cabinet mission plan was much up to his liking, because that was the last chance that India had to remain united. And Maulana was very happy when the cabinet plan was accepted by the Muslim League, by the Congress and the British. But somehow or the other, it failed and India was divided. And as you know, Maulana Azad was very reluctant to join the interim government, which was formed in September 1946. It was much after a lot of persuasion by Mahatma Gandhi and Jawaharlal Nehru that he joined the cabinet in January 1947, and he was given the much important portfolio of education, as subsequently natural resources and scientific research was also added to his ministry because of his great liking for these subjects. And he, as a minister for education, actually the 11 years of his education ministership is a landmark in the history of modern India, because all the laboratories which a network of laboratories right from north to south and east to west, which came up during his education ministership.
He felt after the two world wars that we should try to remove the fear from the mind of people, and to remove the fear and hatred and jealousy from the minds of people, culture can be used the best. He felt that for a proper development of a human mind, it was necessary to develop the emotions of people. And those emotions can only be developed through our art, culture, craft. He founded Lalit Kala Academy, Sahitya Academy, and Sangeet Natak Academy.
Maulana Azad was also, you see, a great supporter of social and economic justice. As far as social justice is concerned, he always supported the cause of the backwards, the cause of the Dalits, and always supported the wrong and those who were oppressed and the backward. He, as far as the economic aspect is concerned, Maulana Azad had prepared a long note for Jawaharlal Nehru before the Awadhi session of the Congress, and said that the battle is between capitalism and socialism. Actually speaking, he said that capitalism and socialism have become two dogmas, and neither of the two systems are prepared to budge an inch from that stand. The best policy would be to adopt a mixed economy, and ultimately it was this mixed economy which he presented as a socialist pattern of society at the Awadhi session. Maulana Azad always felt that he was born in an age for which he was not meant. He actually wrote a letter to his friend Ghulam Rasool Mehr saying that, "I was not meant for this age. Time will come when people will understand me." It was because of this that Maulana Azad always thought that the future generations will appreciate his legacy. Sarojini Naidu has rightly said, "Don't ask of Maulana's age. He was 50 the day he was born." Actually, Maulana Azad was 50 years ahead of his time, and the time has come when we must try to assess the contribution he has made.
As the years go by, Azad's relevance becomes more evident. He foretold the political scenario of our nation many years before the events occurred. He explained the essential unity of all religions, regardless of practice or rituals. He wanted to see the maps of the world painted in one color so that children could visualize the unity of all mankind.